you mentioned earlier that we're producing cholesterol in our cells. We're making cholesterol ourselves.
Absolutely.
And I think that most people think about cholesterol in their body as originating from the food they eat. They think, for example, they eat egg yolk, which is high in cholesterol, if they eat six of those eggs, then their cholesterol, blood cholesterol is going to go up. But that's not necessarily true. Can you explain?
So one of my multiple lives has been in the world of nutrition. Early on, I've been interested in nutrition virtually all my life really came into lipoprotein research because I felt the diet had a very important role in heart disease and the lipoprotein effects of diet. I thought were really important, and I've been studying that now for a long time. So I became involved not just on the research side of things, but also more on the public health side through my work with the American Heart Association. I became chairman of the nutrition committee quite a few years ago now, and I remember that committee, which has now morphed into a larger organization that I helped to establish within the AHA, has been an important part of the American Heart Association's messaging to the public.
You were involved in the dietary guidelines, right?
Yeah, from the American Heart Association. We did that. I actually did that twice. And so I was forced to sort of deal with translating the science, such as it is, about diet and heart disease risk into something that could be actionable. And that's tough because the data linking diet to heart disease risk through any mechanism, like lipids or otherwise, really doesn't necessarily establish a causal role because there's so many features in diet. You can't just easily pick one thing or another. But cholesterol was on the radar screen. So when I became chairman of the nutrition committee on my first cycle, there was a lot of media. I spent a lot of my time dealing with the media, I was just astonished by the questions I would get about dietary cholesterol and blood cholesterol. And as you say, people just conflated those two terms. And I had to spend a considerable portion of my time trying to educate the so-called science, the science writers who were often not trained in science at all. Actually, I'm sorry if I offended anyone, but they're trying to understand this, and they just simplify this story to the point where it becomes totally meaningless. The body makes cholesterol; it regulates the absorption of cholesterol from foods, and the contribution of dietary cholesterol to blood cholesterol. I was actually forced to address this in a very rigorous way through a committee that I was on for the Institute of Medicine of the National Academy of Sciences, which established dietary recommendations for macronutrients, which it was the first time that anybody really did that seriously. So we produced this enormous volume. We had a committee looking at every aspect of macronutrients and health. And my topic, which I had to take on, was cholesterol, dietary cholesterol. And when I went through the literature, I was just astonished at how small the effect is. And it's very difficult to even imagine how an effect of excess dietary cholesterol could influence heart disease risk unless one just either had a mutation that caused the cholesterol to build up or when it was eating an enormous amount of dietary cholesterol. But for the most part, the effect was so small that it was almost unmeasurable. So we wrote that report, I sort of made that point. And then 15 years later, the current dietary guidelines come out saying, well, after all these years of recommending keeping cholesterol less than 300 milligrams per day, we realize there's really no data to support that. And so it took a long time for the U.S. dietary guidelines to catch up. And I was really in a bind because there was this historical precedent of limiting dietary cholesterol because of its potential role in blood cholesterol levels. And it's really not even worth talking about.
But the idea is still out there, and physicians still even recommend not eating eggs.
Yeah. So eggs is in a whole other story. And so again, one moves from dietary components to the foods that those components are contained in, which is really one of the messages that I've tried to emphasize in all the work that we've done, trying to reach the public, which is, again, a nice opportunity here for me to do this with you, is that we should be thinking about the overall context in which those nutrients are ingested, foods and dietary patterns. And finally, the U.S. dietary guidelines are beginning to think about dietary patterns rather than just individual nutrients. However, they still have not abandoned focus on measuring this or that fatty acid. We should be thinking more about the overall food context. And the important regulators of heart disease risk from a dietary standpoint go way beyond the effects on blood cholesterol. And there, we have to think of a lot more complexity in the role of diet. Not that the cholesterol and lipoprotein effects aren't important. And here we can point to saturated fatty acids, for example. We can have a discussion about that if you wish. Raising blood LDL levels, does that translate into higher heart disease risk? Well, it's very hard to show that. In fact, there's almost no evidence to support that relationship. And parenthetically, and maybe importantly, we've shown that the form of LDL that increases with saturated fat is not the small LDL, but the large LDL. And in fact, that led me to question whether or not saturated fat was really an important factor in heart disease risk, because our studies did not show that it was increasing small LDL in the majority of the population. There are individuals who are hyper responders who probably ought to stay away from saturated fat. But for the general population, I began to suspect that this relationship was not as strong as people thought, because it was the less dangerous form of LDL that was increased by saturated fat. And in fact, that's what we showed. And I've gotten involved now in a lot of, I've taken a lot of heat for that. But as time has gone on, we first published this with Dr. Siri Torino in my group about 5 years ago now. And it was, we were really hit hard when we published that first paper, questioning the relationship of saturated fat to heart disease risk. I'm glad to say that over the last year or two, there have been a number of reports that have supported that absence of a strong relationship. And the LDL particle story, I think, may be part of the reason for that, but there may be other factors as well. Again, it may not be the saturated fat itself that has been that should be incriminated here. It should be the foods in which that is consumed. And there may be, for example, in fact, there is evidence from epidemiology that red meat, particularly processed red meat, which contains saturated fat, may have adverse effects on heart disease as well as life itself, life expectancy, and other diseases. And it may not be the saturated fat that's the most important factor there.
Right.
We don't know.